he's helping Lloyd, and then as they're pulling out the pole, then the A3 Skywarrior, you see the A3 Skywarrior did not hit the Pentagon at 9:31:39. It went on a 4-minute and 48-second circle around Washington and then came back north of Sitco and struck the Pentagon at column line 11, but it struck the second-story concrete slab elevation. So the bad guys, they had a problem. They were trying to drop that E-ring roof at 9:31 in order to simulate a crash. And then they failed at the second explosion at 9:36:27. They failed again. And so then that's whenever Rumsfeld and the FBI, Special Agent Combs, he showed up. He was like there instantly with the fire chief. His name was Schwartz. That was his friend. Those guys are buddies. Those guys ran the operation.
Right.
And the reason that the missile went off is because the Lieutenant Governor of New York, actually, he called for Navy support. Whenever the attack started, that caused the commanders to convene in the strong room inside that Navy Intelligence Command Center.
Right.
And that's where the second submunition bombing exploded, right inside that strong room, and killed all the commanders, so that the Navy jets were never launched from the Navy carriers.
Right.
Because the Global Guardian War Games was the cover for this black operation, you see. And so the only part of the Pentagon that was attacked that was not sprinkler protected was in the Defense Intelligence Office in the rear of the C-ring wall. You've probably seen pictures of that hole in the back of the C-ring wall.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Okay, well, that was caused by the third submunition bomblet that blew up against that wall and killed 7 Defense Intelligence people. So those were the good guys. The bad guys were taken out of the way. Same with Navy Command. The good guys were sent into the strong room. The bad guys were removed from the area. The people looking for the $2.3 trillion, they were killed out in the front by submunition bomblet number one. People like April Gallup, if you want to Google her name, she's a sergeant there. And Bill Veal from the Department the Center for 9/11 Justice. I work with them, helping to fix their claims for their lawsuit. I worked on that for them for a while. I've got a blog, 9/11 blog, just blog Terrell at Blogspot, and I've got a big blog there I made just for them for that case. Lots and tons and tons and tons of information that you just really don't know about. So anyway, the operation was at the Pentagon, the Black Op. That's what happened. It was struck by a hypersonic missile at 9:31:39. That's the truth. But the 9/11 Commission report, 585 pages. The Arden County After Action report, 285 pages. None of those pages contain the word explosions even one time.
Oh, jeez.
Both of those documents contain the singular term explosion 6 times. They're both keyword sanitized by the Justice Department. It's our government that ran the inside job. The government documentation proves 9/11 was an inside job.
Right.
Just the government documentation does. But they're all in on it.
Right.
The State Department, the Justice Department, the Supreme Court justices, your people in Congress, they all know 9/11 is an inside job. They know Bush, Cheney, Rumsfeld. They know they're murderers. They know that we have an illegal alien in the White House right now. But they're working for the Council on Foreign Relations in Rothschild. And so they're just puppets. That's why they're not doing anything about it.
Right, right. Now, you focused on the Pentagon and everything. So, I mean, your theories as far as the towers, like you just say, you're just basically throw it off as these things were, when they were built, they were already said to be demolished.
That's true. If you remember the pancaking?
Yeah.
Pancaking. Well, that's going straight down.
Right.
Well, World Trade Center 7 is 350 feet away from North Tower. And North Tower pancaked straight down. World Trade Center 6, that's in its footprint. It didn't implode.
Right.
And the World Trade Center 7 collapsed in 70 feet from its own footprint.
Straight down.
Later that afternoon. And it was emptied out that morning. As a matter of fact, whenever FEMA showed up on the day before, they were sent to Pier 92 by Giuliani.
Uh-huh.
Why'd that happen? The 15th floor of World Trade Center 7 was refitted. $15 million was spent to make that the command bunker.
Right.
That's where FEMA was headed. Well, Giuliani knew that this was coming, so he sent them to Pier 92 instead. And that morning, World Trade Center 7 was empty. There was nobody there.
Right.
Because everybody knew that it was wired for demolition. They knew. And then you see Larry Silverstein.
Silverstein, yeah.
Yeah. Well, he says he was talking to the fire commander about pulling it. No, he was talking to the demolition specialist. That's the guy that pulled it, not the fire commander.
Exactly.
And that they could not control the fire. Well, how did the fire start? This thing's 350 feet away from World Trade Center 7.
Right.
There's no reason for there even to be a fire over there. And even if there was, it's sprinkler protected.
Yep. It would have been out in no time.
it was wired for demolition.
Wow.
It fell in 6.6 seconds. See, it's impossible for a steel frame building to burn down. It's impossible.
Well, yeah.
The reason is because...
In all of history, there hasn't been a steel frame building that has come down because of fire, you know?
it's impossible. The reason is because when you heat up a single member, that heat runs through the entire steel frame network like electricity.
Right.
So in order to heat it up, it's very similar to using cutting torches when you're trying to cut a piece of iron.
Right.
You have to hold that heat on there for a very long time to get it starting to pour flickers.
Yep.
The reason is because the heat is leaving the area faster than you can apply it. And so the hydrocarbon fires just not burn hot enough to burn 2,800 degree red iron steel. It's absolutely impossible. The story told by the government is a deliberate lie. They're all a bunch of inside murders, and now they're covering it up.
I totally believe that was just the biggest slap in the face that America ever got. And everything from that point on, in my opinion, has just been a wake-up call for a lot of people, and it seems to just be getting more and more as time goes by, you know? I just really hope that, I don't know, it's I don't even see a light at the end of the tunnel of what's going to happen with all this.
From those attacks, then you got the continuity of government that was instituted about 10 o'clock that morning.
Right.
They could not get that through except for this kind of catastrophe. So that was pushed through real fast. That's what gave FEMA its authority. And that's what the elites want. That's the Rex 84 concentration camps that they built, over 800 of them in the United States.
Right.
Early 2009, they got their appropriations to begin building those same kind of installations on military bases.
Right.
That's Halliburton. That's Halliburton and Blackwater and those guys. That's Cheney and Rumsfeld and the elite that work for the Council on Foreign Relations.
Yeah,
that's what it's all about.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, you know what? This, like you said, this totally deserves a much longer show, and I'm sure we could get a whole lot, you know, deeper into it and everything. But hey, Terrell, we got like 4 minutes left. I want to use this time and stuff as an opportunity for you to get out any you know, websites that you promote or whatever the case may be. And I'd like to ask you back, you know, if you want to, you know, take the time, you know, once a week, every other week or something, if you want to come on my show at this particular time, you want to, you know, go over some stuff, you're more than welcome. So.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, you can join our research by downloading PalTalk Messenger. Go to www.paltalk.com. It's free. It's just like Windows Messenger or any messenger program else like that. And then look for Terrell's Astronomy Research Room. It's under Education and Other, and it's free. You can join our discussions, and we share links. We're watching earthquakes, solar flares. We're watching the corrupt government, and sharing links. And when something happens, then you'll know about it. And if you have a question, just like you're asking me questions, I'm there most of the day. Then you can ask questions and get your answer right off. You know, go right up to the mic, ask your question, and get your answer right then.
Are those rooms really crowded?
We keep 50, 60, 70 people in there at a time.
Wow, that's quite a bit of people. And everybody's just doing something regarding the heavy mass object, or is that the only thing that's for?
No, not at all. We have like one member there that is from several groups that he checks back in with us. Some people are there just to receive information. They stop in, they want to know what's happening. You know, they want to keep their finger on the pulse of what's going on.
Right.
You have survival questions. We have astronomers. The astronomers are not as important in our research right now because our object's in the daytime sky. But very soon, in about 6 to 8 weeks, they're going to become very important. And then that's where they come to receive their coordinates, and that's where then they go out and do their observations, and that's where they bring back their information and share it with everybody. We stream right now. We're doing 3 radio shows a week, and so we stream that through there. And that's a place for researchers to gather together to get information and to share their information.
Good deal, good deal. Anything else that you want to throw out there?
You can check out my videos on YouTube. TerralO3, and stay updated. If you'll subscribe, then whenever something big happens that I make a video, it'll show up in your box, and then you can check us out. There'll be links there on how to get to PalTalk in case you can't find it or figure it out. And you're welcome to join us anytime.
Very cool, very cool. Well, Terrell, again, I want to thank you for being on Toxic Reality Radio on freedomizerradio.com. We've got like a minute and a half left. I just want to let people know thank you for coming on today. I've seen that the chat room was full. I didn't have a chance to go over to the chat and do anything because it's when you're doing the show alone, you know, handling the board and you know, looking at the calls and, you know, kind of keeping track of everything and stuff, it's a little you get a little tied up and stuff. So I apologize for not being on there. Don't forget, you know, stay tuned and stuff for the next show. We got Proof Negative on the for the next 3 hours. And then after that, later on tonight at 9 p.m., we got 32 Degrees of Insanity. And I believe I'll be on that show tonight helping out Vicky. So with that, I guess we'll end it there, Terrell. So, hey, thanks a lot, man. I'm going to go into your room and then see what everything was going on in there. I'm really curious to see what goes on in that room. So I thank you so, so much for coming on to my debut show, and I hope to we'll talk soon.
Okay, I appreciate it. Thank you very much.
All right, buddy. Thanks a lot, man.
Okay, we'll see you next time.
All right. Bye-bye now. All right, let's see if I could get rid of this thing here. I can't do this, so I guess I'm just going to have to end it there. So, all right, guys, thanks for joining me. We'll talk soon, everyone.